the audio from the camera, please.
Okay, so it's direct.
Yeah.
So every boo-boo will be there, right? So if you say amen, it's going to be there. Open your Bibles to Genesis, please. Chapter 1. Genesis 1. And verse 30 and 31. Finally, we have come to the 6th day. It's been almost, what, I don't know, 20 years away. It's been a long way, right? First chapter, it's about a year, right? So, verse 30, we're going to read. Let's read it all together. Let's start. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that breathes upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good, and the evening and the morning were the same day. So much. Adam and Eve, the resources he will give them for life sustainability. He announces diversity of herbs and trees, fruit trees. But when he mentioned the animals' resources, he speaks of one kind of herb, which is in general what he calls the green. In general, but it's only one herb kind for the diversity of animals. Now, with men, there are only, you know, there's a great diversity of foods. Wow, men is only one kind. So imagine the wonderful privilege that we have that the animals don't have. So we have such a vast of choices, you know, to make because God has created us that way. We reason, we have a will, we can make, you know, choices and, you know, decide and reason. And because of that, you know, the Lord has created all this diversity of thousands of, you know, vegetables, fruits, that exist So we have to respect the way that God has created us, you know, according to the word, is to his likeness, means to his image, and the capacity that the Lord has given us, the ability to understand and to reason, very important as well. So we get to choose in the thousands of flavors by animals cannot. And so that is a great, wonderful revelation that you and I should enjoy all the time, you know, acknowledging God, you know, provision for us as humans. So we already studied verse 29, which that's the portion, that verse that speaks of the many trees and many herbs that, you know, the Lord provided for us, and we learned so much from that verse. Now we're going to concentrate on the animal provision. And I want you to understand something. We're going to apply the word of God, of course, in our lives, because that's what it's all about. So the Lord says there in verse 30, and to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the earth, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life. Notice that sentence. I have given every green herb for meat. Right? And we're going to apply that sentence. When it says the Lord, I have given every green herb for meat. We're going to do two parts, and then we're going to come back later than that, and it will. So we see first here that the Lord says, I have given every green herb for meat, and it will sow. We can learn two important things that is applicable even for us to learn. First, letter A, if you would have notes there. The goodness of God toward animals. God is so good for animals. And, you know, I have from time to time said that I don't like cats, and I'm being honest. I don't like the way they, you know, I like the, when I was practicing martial arts, you know, Bruce Lee has some styles of cat, you know, attacks and exercising, and I learned some of that stuff when I was practicing those things. And I see that the oriental application of the philosophy of having, you know, animals, systems that they create for their own, you know, survival, and then the Orientals take those, you know, systems of those animals or techniques or, you know, survival mode of defending themselves to create a system of fighting and defending. And so Mr. Bruce Lee did that. And the only way that I like about cats is the, you know, flexibility, the speed that they have when they move, when they watch, when they jump and all that, because all of that, it was part of the system of the techniques that Mr. Tree used to have. That's the only thing that I like about cats. But having cats, you know, around my lap, I don't know. But I know you have your choices. That's my choice. You know, I like to see them. I like to, you know, they're beautiful. They just, you know, the one thing that I don't like about them, first of all, I'm allergic to it, okay? Because I used to have these allergies very powerful. The only thing is the sloth, you know, the passive life that they carry. They don't do anything. They just eat, sleep, and just play around with little things. And I mean, the only only thing that I appreciate about them is when they call, you know, Mike. I love that word, all right? And they can be useful to that speak. But other than that, you know. Anyway, but you know, I have learned as I studied this topic, I have learned to appreciate even the cats from God's point of view. And this is where, you know, you need to make a switch when you don't understand something, then something, you know, God teaches you something from his perspective, then this is when I make switches. I can change my mind. Because God says so. When he says so, then I respect and then I honor his word. And for that, I'm considering, you know, otherwise what I said. So my inclination as human is what I said. But from God's perspective, you know, I respect him. And the way that I want to communicate this topic is I want you to understand is I teach these songs. I'm learning and applying it to myself. And this is the way that I've learned the Word of God. It's not just preaching it. It's not just listening and understanding the application who needs it, but also the first person who will need it is the one who is getting the message before the Lord. Right? So it's for me too. Right? So this is very important. So the goodness of God to animals. I want you to turn to the Psalm 104. And you see here. Something wonderful, the Lord. That he is present. Now notice, he uses David to write about it. And so Psalm 104, verse 10. Notice, he sendeth the spring into the valleys, which run among the hills. Look at this picture. They give drink to every beast. Now remember that word "they" speaks of the valleys. Right? That word valleys, they is the same word. They give drink to every beast of the field. And wild asses quench their thirst. Now noticing how he takes care of them. By them, then, the valleys, shall the fowls of the heaven have their habitations, which sing among the branches. See the poetic and the description right there, it's so beautiful. Okay? Now notice verse 13. He watered the hills with his fingers. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of thy roots. You see that mentioned? That the earth is so satisfied for what God is providing. In verse 14, he causes the grass to grow up for the cattle, okay, and herb for the service of men, that he may bring forth food. Isn't that wonderful? The scripture is so beautiful. It's like the beginning of a wonderful book. We can just read from these verses. Then see the connotation and the application of the book of verses. Now, when we understand God's perspective, you know, why he explains this, and then he gives us this, you know, the scenery of what he's doing behind all of these, the life of, the animals, and what they expect. Obviously, none of them can know or work, you know, as the Lord Jesus Christ would mention it when he speaks about the goodness of God. So this is how good God is, all right? And you know, unless you understand the goodness of God and the mercy of God, you can never know God, literally. You can never know him. And you can never experience God conscience, settle it in your conscience, because you don't understand what he means, the goodness of God. So the goodness of God is not just giving, you know, birth a child, a mother giving birth a child, and then, you know, everything went well, because we always pray for that. Or, you know, something that is given to a person that is needy. And there's a much of that going right now, this moment on earth, every day, every morning, every afternoon. God's goodness is all over. So, but you see that the goodness of God can never be understood in your conscience, settle it, you know, really in your soul, unless you understand God and where his perspective of that goodness is. The Lord Jesus Christ speaks about the goodness of God in Matthew, and gives us a glimpse of what we just read from Psalm 104. I just wanted you to absorb Psalms, but now let's put it in perspective of God himself, Jesus Christ, speaking to us, all right, about this wonderful goodness of the Lord and how he manifests his goodness. Notice Matthew 6, please, in verse 26. This is the, you know, the scriptures where the Lord is speaking about the goodness of the Lord toward men and toward animals, humans and animals. Now, Lord is saying, we can just, you know, read from verse 23. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. That's the, you know, the perspective of humans, always dark. Right? Men always see the evil and inclined to do evil. That's what the Bible says. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? In other words, you can never make it on your own. No man can serve two masters, the Lord says, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. He cannot serve God and mammon, speaking of money, or power. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought. Now notice, this is where the goodness of the Lord comes. You know, there's a void with men, with humans. There we be pride. We deprave. We are inclined to sin, to darkness, to evil. Okay? And so he comes, the Lord is explaining to us in verse 25, and then also continues there. Therefore I say unto you, he says, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, not yet for your body, what ye shall put on. It's not the life for men, then, is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? That's a great question, a great perspective. By the way, behold, the Lord says, and this is an explanation of the goodness of God. Look, behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, notice, nor gather any barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? There it is, the comparison. See, humans are way more worthy, okay, than animals. Therefore, that's why the comparison, we can never compare, or, you know, we are like chimpanzees, or, you know, if they are like us, don't even go there. Science do that, you know, but God doesn't do that. The Lord puts, you know, every creature in the right perspective. And the Lord is saying here, aren't you as humans more valuable than the ravens and, you know, the birds or the animals? The Lord provides sacrifice for both of them. So the Lord is saying here, she is speaking and describing the goodness of the Lord and his perspective as well. So the Lord is giving to the animals, but is also providing to the humans. But you see, the reasoning for humans is that there's a saying that is in Spanish, if you don't work, you don't eat. Okay? I don't know if you have it in the Philippines, here in the English, you know, in America, I don't know how you know it. But, you know, that's the saying. You know, if I don't depend on my work, my energy, then I would not eat. Wait a minute. The Lord says different. And this is, you see, the Lord knows better because he's the one who created us. So, you know, I understand that, you know, we're talking about the abilities, the intelligence, the courses that we took for a certain training that we have, you know, accomplished and so forth. And I understand that, but, the process of learning, the process of understanding, the process of, you know, our brain sustaining and reserve information, it doesn't come from humans. It comes from the one who provides the capacity that we have to do that. And so to accomplish that, unless we acknowledge him as the one God, is the one who's providing all of this, you know, the abilities that we have to do or to function in our works and our duties, it doesn't mean much if you don't acknowledge who gave you that ability. So, therefore, everything just boils down in the provision of God. So God is speaking here that God will provide to the humans also the need that they have. So that means it's not only the food, but it means also the means to get the food. It means the intelligence to get the work. It means the ability to understand, you know, your procedure or your, you know, responsibilities. All of that is provided by God. It's not talking about just food. It's the ability, it's the energy, it's the wisdom, it's the discerning, it's everything. So we must understand the goodness of the Lord and our perspective. You see, because we can discern, we can understand, and we can reason. So the Lord is saying, behold, the Lord is saying, hey, take a look. You know, the birds, right? The Lord said in verse 26, of the air, for they sow not. They don't do anything. They just, you know, I have my office on the top of the second floor of my house, and I designed this window to be there in my office because I love, you know, I like to contemplate the outside while I'm studying and contemplating, you know, God's greatness. And so I always look at, you know, through the window. And so there's gables there. There's a beautiful scenery there. And we have in that area a lot of birds. And it's beautiful. It's just, you know, it's just wonderful to understand that without the birds, I mean, a day will be dead without, you know, the singing of the birds and all that. Because that they bring life, you know, in the morning. When you get up and you see them, you know, they're chirping, and they, especially the mockingbird, all these, you know, noises that he does, and all these beautiful things. And you know, they don't do much. It's just, you know, there are people, the flying of the birds, they don't, perhaps they're not bothered, but it's the singing of the birds they get bothered. And so I don't understand that part, because birds, you know, they don't bother unless they're, you know, ravens. They're pretty. They don't have a note there. I mean, they just rap, you know. But, you know, every other birds, they have beautiful, you know, sounds and singing and beautiful way of So that's all they do. They don't do much. They, you see, by doing that themselves, they're not creating anything. They're not producing anything for themselves. They are doing that for us, and so that we can enjoy it. But the Lord takes care of them. That's what the Bible says. And good care of them. Because I have seen them, I don't know if you, like in summertime, you will see little birds looking for little puddles of water, right? Because they are thirsty. They're thirsty. They're flying back and forth. And I have noticed that in certain, you know, occasions, I have seen little puddles of water, and these little birds, you know, coming, they take a bath and they, you know, drink and just, you know, fly away. How in the world, you know, they just find their way, their food, their means to live and to survive. It's only God who gives them that ability to find where and to eat what. You know, all of that is such a wonderful thing. Now, so the goodness of God through animals, we can see it all over in the Bible. Now, letter B. Let's talk about the sovereignty of God. Sovereignty of God toward animals. In verse 30, the Lord says there that what he had done, okay, for them, speaking of the provision of the herd, he said, it was so. Right? That expression there, it's very powerful. And it speaks of the sovereignty of God, okay? That what he has said, done, it must happen. It must take place. That's the sovereignty of God. With the animals God created, what he wants continues to be so. It didn't happen any other way, right? So the vast creatures of the sea never, listen to this, never have created a revolt against their creator. I never have seen, you know, creatures of the sea coming out or going on the, you know, in the air and saying, okay, we had it. It's enough. We don't want no more to live in under the water. Never seen it. What God created, it is. It's been there, all right? They're there, and it was so, and that's how it is. And nobody can change it, not even themselves. So all the animal kingdom has never rejected God's sovereignty or his will. Never. You never seen, you know, elephants going against, you know, strike, right? Lions, you know, come into cities and, you know, just eating and devouring people and say, okay, we have, you know, you guys killing us and nothing. You never seen animals do that, okay? Because what God has done, has planted, has settled, that's what it is. That's his sovereignty. And so my question to you, so that we can apply what we are listening and hearing, is it the same with men? That, you know, like the animals, they never revolt. They never go against or reject the will of God. Is it the same with men? If you're honest, it's not the same. You know, with men, and again, this is the situation. Because we have will and we have reasoning. And too much more, don't you think that because we have reasoning and will, don't you think that we should be more controlled and be more grateful to God for what he had done with our lives? Because he has given us a lot more than the animals. By the way, the animals don't go and revolt. They don't go and reject God and he's doing his creation and whatever he has established. None of that. But while we go and rebellious against God's sovereignty and will, when we have reasoning and will to, you know, consider our ways of living and then to honor him or not honor him, And so we have that freedom. And boy, we do the opposite. We are the one offending God. That's the reason there's so many laws that, you know, God has given to us that we submit, that we need to submit. Because other than that, if he had not written them, we will be just going wild like the animals, you know? Because our reasoning is like what it feels good, it tends to be the driven motivation for even humans, what it feels good. What, you know, I like, what I delight in is not what is necessary, is not what is right, but it's what it feels good. Even right now, as of today, that's the kind of like the tendency, you know, or the trend that is going on in our societies, in our societies. What it feels good for me, that's what I'm going to do. And what is convenient to me, that's what I'm going to, you know, do. But it, not what is right, what is just, what is true, what is correct. That is not the case. And what it feels good, what I need. So this is the egocentric element of humans that always, you know, is playing against God's laws and benefit that he has given to us. And we are always clashing with God and the Word of God and with the Spirit of God and the plans of God. We always clashing with him. Always, always, always. Because our tendency is to do, no, but that doesn't feel good. You know, if people are, you know, always thinking, always, you know, the emotional elements come in, whatever they feel is like, I don't feel good. If, you know, I deserve better. I have my rights. This is what is better for me, and so forth. And so, animals don't say that. Animals don't reason that way. And so, I think we have so much from the animals. We have so much to learn. And you know, it is hard to say, let's learn from the animals. Us? Learning from the animals? Well, let me prove it to you from the Word, okay? Because even the greatest human, you know, wise man ever lived, besides Jesus Christ, and the book of Proverbs gives us a little glimpse of a scenario that where we can learn from a little creature, right? In chapter 6, Proverbs 6, verse 6. Go to the ant. Go to the ant. Thou sluggard. This is a great application and teaching from the Lord to us. Notice, consider her ways and be wise. Which had no guide, overseer, or ruler, provideth her meat in the summer, and gathereth her food in the harvest. And how long wilt thou sleep, O sluggard? What wilt thou arise out of thy sleep? You see, the Lord is giving us there a scenario that, wow, sometimes we need to learn from the animals. Because we don't get it. This sluggard is just, you know, scratching his tummy, and when he's hungry, he's gonna cry out for hunger. Or when he's thirsty, he's gonna go and get to, you know, quench the thirst. But when it comes to duties, it's like, I don't feel like it. That's the sluggard. That's the person that will always depend on somebody else's. And so the Lord is saying here, please learn. Look at this creature, what they do, what they can accomplish with no guidance, no reasoning. They, you know, are under an instinct. They act upon some design that I have designed, which is very limited. They cannot say themselves, know, so we can learn so much from the way they do the work and their ethics and whatever you call it. But a clear moment when the will of God was put to a test between a man and an animal, it was given to us in the Bible. I want you to turn to the book of Numbers 22. This is a great example of how the Lord puts man and animal in comparison, okay? And the Lord is seeking for obedience, remember. God is a father, always is seeking his children to be obedient, submissive, not to just, you know, get their way, okay? The Lord is seeking obedience. First, I'm going to read Numbers 22, verse 1. And the children of Israel set forth homeward and pitched in the plains of Moab on this side of Jordan by Jericho. And Balak, the son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites. And Moab was sore afraid of the people because they were many. And Moab was distressed because of the children of Israel. Moab said unto the elders of Midian, now shall this company lift up all that are around about us, as the ox lifteth up the grass of the field. Balak, the son of Zippor, was king of the Moabites at that time. Notice who the king was. And then, you know, the group of the ethnicity is the Moabites. Now, he sent messengers, therefore, unto Balaam. This is an old prophet in those days. Notice, the son of Beor, to Pethor, which is by the river of the land of the children of his people, to call him, saying, behold, there is a people come out from Egypt. Behold, they cover the face of the earth, and they abide over against me. So now, he has learned that this king, the Moabite, learned that this Balaam guy, prophet, when he cursed, the people were cursed. And when he blessed, people were blessed. So he had an idea. He was afraid of the people of Israel coming from Egypt and what they were going, through. They were literally, doing some conquering, and the Lord was using them. So he was afraid. So he said, well, if I call Balaam, maybe I can call him to come to work for me and to curse them. So that, everything that they plan to do, it will go sideways. And so that's what he tried to do. So he sent a company of people to call him to come by, all right, and to see where the people were staying and camping, so Balaam would curse them. Well, in the whole deal, Balaam said to the ones who were requesting the invitation, giving the invitation to go to his kingdom, he said, let me, you guys will stay here, and I'm going to make sure that God is approving this. So what he said is that he's going to check with God about that invitation. And so that's what, he did. So he consulted with God, and then the Lord answered to him and said, no, don't go. Because that people, they didn't apparently is going to go and curse, they're blessed. You cannot reverse what I did. So they're blessed. So the people were, so Balaam in the morning, the people and say, hey, tell your king that God said I can't go. So the people went back and then gave the message, So he sent people back to Balaam, and these are more, you know, important people. There were some princes even into the groups that they were born to try to convince Balaam that he will get, you know, so much benefit from the king if he would do what he's asking for him to do. So then they came, same thing, stay, I'm gonna double check with God. But what did God say first? No, don't go, because those people are blessed. You can have, you know, do the reverse. So he went, see, here we go. Okay, this is a prophet of God. I don't mean he knows God. When God says something, you must submit, right? And did he do that? No, he didn't do it. He did not submit. He said, well, maybe that will check with him. Maybe he changed his mind or something. That's, you know, the Bible doesn't say that. I'm kind of playing with his thinking. No. So, to make this story short, because there's a lot of reading here. So he said, God appeared to him again. He said, so why, you know, why are these people coming to you again? You know? He said, well, you know, they want to know if you allow me to go. Then the Lord said, hey, it's like David did not understand what God's will was, because he was still knocking the door to be open and to see if God would change his mind. Now think about this. This is how you see the reasoning here. Balaam is playing with reason. All right, God already gave orders, directions, and what is he doing? He's just playing, right? And then saying, "Well, maybe God can, you know, change his mind because of me, because, you know, I'm his favor, right? Because, you know, he could allow me to get all these goodies that, you know, the king is offering me, and I know God wants the best for me. So maybe, just maybe, he would change his mind." And the Lord did not, he didn't change his mind. But he continued and said, okay, go with them. The Lord allowed him to go with them. Think about it. But then the Lord says, the next, he said, but you're going to do and say what I'm going to tell you to do. Say. As he was going, right, he was riding a donkey, right, to the place that he was going to. Now, in the way to the place with the king, where Balaam was going to meet the king, there was an angel with a sword, right, trying to make a stumbling block to Balaam in his way. Balaam could not see it, the angel, only the donkey saw the angel. Now think about it. There's something going on here. And this is what I want you to understand when I'm presenting to you before you is the reaction of an animal and the reaction of a human, okay? How it is, you know, the reality of this. So the animal, the donkey, when he saw the angel with the bear sword in his hand, I'm sure it was shining, it was right there, because the Bible describes the angel right in the air. Right? So they were going in the path, and then boom, the angel right there. So the donkey understood, okay, this is divine. This is my creator. This is a messenger from my creator. So what he did, the animal did, he just turned the other direction. He didn't continue. Now you understand it, that what is indicated here? The decision making of an animal. He needed to make a decision. The animal, by instinct, understood what is taking place. So So he turned. He was avoiding going in that direction, right? Perhaps the Lord communicated somehow. But so the donkey continued in a different trail or path, all right? And then Balaam was really, by this time he was really mad because the donkey was, you know, directing now it's a new path. And then Balaam could not control the animal and said, he was, you know, hitting the animals and to, you know, to go back to the path, the original path. And he was going in the other direction. And then they came to a, the Bible says that the Lord allowed like a fence, kind of like narrow, right? And so when the donkey was trying to get this narrow pass, he couldn't even pass there because the legs of Balaam were, you know, really squashing the fences where he was going. And so that got him real mad, you know, to the extent that the animal couldn't even pass, and then he just dropped on the floor. And then by the whole scenario, the circumstance there, Balaam says something to the animal. And he was just cursing the animal and all the stuff. And hitting him. And then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey and started talking to Balaam. And say, why are you hitting me? Okay. And then he says, don't you own me? I'm yours. I've been riding you for all the longest since you got me. And I belong to you. Why are you hitting me? And then he replied, Balaam replied, if I would have, you know, something, he said, to kill you, I would kill you. He said that. And then that was the moment. See the beautiful moment here. This is I want you to put attention to this. Do you see the reaction of the animal when they saw the divine? He immediately understood what to do. Now, here we go. Balaam, God revealed Balaam the presence of the angel at that moment. And then he saw the angel. And then the angel defended the donkey. And he said, if he would have never turned the way he did, you would be dead now. That's what he said, the angel told him. You'd be dead because you were going against the will of God. And so what happened, the animal helped him to spare the life. That's why he turned. In other words, the angel is saying, this donkey, the one that you want to kill right now, save your life. Save your life. Do you see that importance? So who was more into aligned in the profile of the will of God in this juncture? Is the animal or the human? Is obviously the human, not the human. Not the human. Okay, so that's the reality. And the world that we live in, that we don't submit to God. We do whatever we want. And the animals always comply, because what is established for the animals is being done. It's being done yesterday, it's done today, even today, same, it's continued. Nothing has changed. So that's the reality. So, and also, let me put it this in perspective, because there's so much here that it connects, you know, this thinking. Let's not forget the greatest prophetic entrance recorded in the New Testament, when the Lord Jesus rode the donkey, when he way, that entrance was a picture of the greatest moment when our Lord Jesus will come into the earth victorious with his redeemed army on white horses to reclaim what belongs to him. That teaches about Revelation. When the Lord, in chapter 19, the Lord is coming with the redeemed. We could come in, right? So we come in on white horses. We're talking about animals in heaven, all right? And they're white. So this is the reality. See, in all of these moments in the scripture where donkey and horses are used for prophetic fulfillments, I believe God is honoring the animal kingdom. I believe, he cannot bring all of them, but as he also uses the lamb, for instance, for sacrifice, the lion is an identity. The dove is identity for the spirit. The cow, even the ravens, the Lord uses even to provide food to Elijah. The ravens. So we can see that with the animals, what God has established, it was so and it still is. We have so much to learn from the animal kingdom in nature as they honor God's beauty. You see, you and I as humans have a problem with sovereignty, with God's sovereignty. We don't like to be oversee or rule or supervise. We have a problem with that. The animal is born. So we have so much to do. So we need to submit, our reasoning, our will, our understanding is to arrive there and say, Lord, that's why Jesus Christ, teaches about God's will. Even in the darkest moment of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, he uses that God's will be done, even though it'll hurt him much. But the Lord says, may your will be done according to God's will. And then we fulfill. And that's the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible said that he was sweating like drops of blood that came into his head. Because of the moment it was so crucial. Then he said, well, it's me. He was asking Mary, has this cup, this hurt, this mission. Then he said, how are then the will of God will be done? So therefore, he says, okay, I surrender to the will of God. So, do your will. If the Lord Jesus Christ at that moment had decided anything else, you and I would be going straight to hell. Because that was the pain of us. And I'm getting to pay for us. Thank God for Jesus Christ. And he's obedient to the will of God and his sovereignty. He's obedient to him. May we learn from the Lord Jesus Christ. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. It's so important to understand your will and your sovereignty. Even the animals, we can learn from them how they submit to you, and they fear you because of who you are. May we learn to honor you for who you are in our lives, and help us to see ourselves as nothing before the wonderful, greatest God that we have. As Sister Jonah plays the hymn.
Okay.